Good evening. Welcome to North American Martyrs. Please stand for the opening hymn. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. It's a wonderful evening to welcome our seniors who have come for the senior mass. It's truly a blessing to be able to send you off with the holy sacrifice of the mass to wherever our Lord sees fit to see you grow and flourish. Brethren, let us acknowledge our sins, and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries. I confess to Almighty God, and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done and in what I have failed to do, through my most grievous fault. Therefore I ask, Blessed Mary, ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and to you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Amen. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
We praise Let us pray. O God, who through the grace of adoption chose us to be children of light, grant, we pray, that we may not be wrapped in the darkness of error, but always be seen and to stand in the bright light of truth. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
A reading from the second book of Kings. One day, Elisha came to Shunem, where there was a woman of influence, who urged him to dine with her. Afterward, whenever he passed by, he used to stop there to dine. So she said to her husband, "I know that Elisha is a holy man of God, since he visits us often. Let us arrange a little room on the roof and furnish it for him with a bed, table, chair, and lamp, so that when he comes to us, he can stay there." Sometime later, Elisha arrived and stayed in the room overnight. Later, Elisha asked, "Can something be done for her?" His servant Gehazi answered, "Yes. She has no son, and her husband is getting on in years." Elisha said, "Call her." When the woman had been called and stood at the door, Elisha promised, "This time next year, you'll be fondling a baby son." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Forever I will sing the goodness of the Lord. Forever I will sing the goodness of the Lord. The promise of the Lord I will sing forever. Through all the generations my mouth shall proclaim your faithfulness. For you have said my kindness is established forever. In heaven you have confirmed your faithfulness. Forever I will sing the goodness of the Bless the people who know the joyful shout. In the light of your countenance, O God, they walk. At your name they rejoice all the day. And through your justice they are exalted. Forever I will sing of the Lord. You are the splendor of their strength, and by your favor our horn is exalted. For to the Lord belongs our shield, and to the Holy One of Israel our King. Forever I will sing the goodness of the Lord.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. Brothers and sisters, are you unaware that we who are baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? We were indeed buried with him through baptism into death, so that, just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might live in a newness of life. If, then, we have died with Christ, we believe that we shall also live with him. We know that Christ, raised from the dead, dies no more. Death no longer has power over him. As to his death, he died to sin once and for all. As to his life, he lives for God. Consequently, you too must think of yourselves as dead to sin and living for God in Christ Jesus. The word of the Lord.
Of him who called you out of darkness into this wonderful light.
Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia.
The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew. Jesus said to his apostles, "Whoever loves father or mother more than me is not worthy of me. And whoever loves son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. And whoever does not take up his cross and follow after me is not worthy of me. Whoever finds his life will lose it, and whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. Whoever receives you receives me, and whoever receives me receives the one who sent me. Whoever receives a prophet because he is a prophet will receive a prophet's reward. But whoever receives a righteous man because he is a righteous man will receive a righteous man's reward. And whoever gives only a cup of cold water to one of these little ones to drink, because the little one is a disciple, amen, I say to you, he will surely not lose his reward." The Gospel of the Lord. First off, just wanted to congratulate again our graduates for graduating from one of the oddest years on record. You survived, you made it through to this moment. So praise God for that. You're going to be entering into a whole new world, so to speak, with regards to your education. But the one clear thing that our Lord always tells us is that I am with you, that I am with you, that I will never leave you, I will never abandon you, and that I am present to you in each of those moments. A few years ago, I had the grace of going to an abbey, a Benedictine monastery that was being built and is still being built in Clear Creek, Oklahoma. Now imagine the Oklahoma summer. Brutal, brutally hot. And so we arrived there, and I'd say the monastery is about half completed at this point. It's about 20 years since it started. When they first started, they bought about 1,000 acres of land that was used for grazing for horses. And so it's pretty barren land out there. And when the monks arrived, they just had tents to begin living their monastic vows and life there, and began building up everything around them, from cultivating the land, from having sheep brought all the way over from Australia that could handle the harsh conditions there, as well as building cells for the monks. But the first thing that they built was beginning on the chapel. And then after that section was that completed, they started building their place for receiving visitors. This was a very important aspect of Benedictine life. And so when we arrived there, we were greeted most humbly by the monks of the abbey. Most of the time is silence for them. They have an hour of recreation each day where they can actually talk and speak. What part of monastic life is that they can speak if it's necessary, but otherwise they work in silence. But it was just a wonderful, beautiful example of hospitality that was shown to us through the Benedictine rule of life. For St. Benedict tells us that when a visitor should arrive, when a guest arrives at the monastery, they are to be welcomed as Christ. This goes back to Matthew 25:35, that we, whenever we receive a stranger, that we receive Christ himself. So we really felt welcomed by them. So when a guest enters in, the superior and brothers go to meet them out of courtesy and love. They're there to pray with them, to give them a sign of peace, and to humbly address them. This beautiful virtue of humility is expanded upon within the monastery. But it's a virtue for all Christians that we enter into, because hospitality is essentially an openness and attitude of the heart that opens us up to others to receive them. And we see this beautiful example flowing through from our Old Testament reading today of hospitality. For within this, it creates a free space where a stranger can enter in and become a friend instead of an enemy. You know, they do not have to be afraid when they enter this place. It is here that they can receive new life. So everywhere they go, this is a place that is open so that way their gifts can flourish and be present there. And not only that, but each member that's present is willing to be vulnerable to one another there. So it's important that somebody who's practicing hospitality needs to let go of their narcissism, so focus on themselves, or their exaggerated individualism, you know, inflating themselves up. No, it's not about them. It's about this person who's entering in, who is Christ. And so we see this in the Old Testament with Elisha traveling, and this woman who sees him and welcomes him. She urges him to come into her house. She opens up her home to Elisha. And there he dines with them. You know, he's welcomed by them. He converses with them. And he's found to be a friend. And not only that, but she anticipates his needs for him. She sees the need for him to have a place to rest. And so she prepares putting a place aside for him to go and to rest. And there he's able to come and spend time with them. You know, as a light sleeper, I can very much appreciate somebody setting aside a place for me where I can, you know, be a little vulnerable. I've woken up many a time to many noises in the night, including roommates. So I very much appreciate, having that place to rest, to enter into. And not only that, but we see that hospitality has a wonderful effect upon our hearts. It opens us up, our whole being, to create a space of openness, this generosity to others, to give of ourselves to one another. As Christians, we have to take a step further, for we recognize not just that this is a stranger in need of being welcomed. You know, so that way they don't get back at us later when we need to be welcomed. No. We give because we recognize it's Christ. We give without expecting anything in return. You know, I wonder how many of you have seen the movie Les Miserables. It's in that scene there where we have the bishop who welcomes Jean Valjean, who has just been released as a convict. And everywhere he's gone, he's been rejected, he's been thrown out. But the bishop welcomes him into his home. He has him dine with him at his table, and he gives him a place to sleep. And how does Jean Valjean treat this then? Well, in the middle of the night, he gets up and he steals the silver out of the household. And as the bishop hears this rustling, he gets up and Jean Valjean attacks him, strikes him, knocks him down, and runs away. And the next day, as the bishop is out, you know, continuing his work, the police show up with Jean Valjean, and they ask him, "Is this your silver? Is this your silver, bishop? We caught this man who said that you gave it to him." And the bishop said, "Why, yes, I did give him that silver. But my boy, you ran away so soon. Why didn't you take the candlesticks as well? They're worth at least 30 lire." And so Jean Valjean is astonished at this. And as the police go off, the bishop comes up to him and hands him the candlesticks and says, "Seize Jean Valjean. With this silver, I have ransomed you, and I set you aside now for Christ." We welcome everybody that we meet as if they were Christ. No matter where they come from, no matter their disposition, no matter what their race, ethnicity might be, it doesn't matter. Whether they're sick, we welcome them each as Christ. And graduates, you're going to be confronted with this when you go into your colleges, into the military, into places of service. Will I treat them like Christ? And will I treat them as Christ would treat them? Will I expand my heart to welcome them? You know, in our current predicament with COVID, instead of treating the stranger as a friend to be welcomed, now they're seen as an enemy, somebody who could do harm to me. You know, the monks that set up monasteries in and throughout the Alps and other areas, they even welcomed bandits into their home. They welcomed those who might have done harm to them. They were willing to accept those who might have a possibility of doing harm. That's the risk that we take as being Christians with our generosity. But it's something worth living. It's something worth of giving. Because Christ is the one who in and of himself will set us free to be generous, to give of ourselves, to move from hostility to friendship. And it's something that the world struggles with. So as we come to our Eucharistic Lord today, may we pray in a special way that we may receive that beautiful virtue of hospitality, that hospitality that our Lord speaks of when he says, whoever receives you receives me, and whoever receives me receives the one who sent me. Let us stand now and profess our faith. I believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary, and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, the Father and the Son, Lord and Lord, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Turning to our Heavenly Father, may we bring all of our prayers and petitions to him.
For all Christians, that we die to sin and live for God in Christ Jesus, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For governors and lawmakers, that they respect freedom of religion in all their votes and decisions, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our nation, as we prepare to celebrate Independence Day, that we be thankful for all who have given service to keep our country free, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our vulnerable populations, that God protects our elderly and those suffering from chronic disease, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For our parish family, as children of light, that we strive to follow the bright light of truth, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
We pray for the repose of the soul of John Ascoff, for whom this Mass is offered, and for the needs of all here present, for which we now pause to pray. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. God, the Father of mercies, through the intercession of the North American martyrs and St. Kateri, hear and answer all of these prayers and petitions that we have confidently brought before your presence, especially for our graduates who will soon head out into the world. And we ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Brethren, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. O God, who graciously accomplished the effects of your mysteries, grant, we pray,
that the deeds by which we serve you may be worthy of these sacred gifts, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For out of compassion for the waywardness that is ours, he humbled himself and was born of the Virgin. By the passion of the cross he freed us from an unending death, and by rising from the dead he gave us life eternal. And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the hosts and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory, as without end we acclaim.
To you, therefore, most merciful Father, we make humble prayer and petition through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, that you accept and bless these gifts, these offerings, these holy and unblemished sacrifices, which we offer you firstly for your holy Catholic Church. Be pleased to grant her peace, to guard, unite, and govern her throughout the whole world, together with your servant Francis, our Pope, and James, our Bishop, and all those who holding on to the truth and on the Catholic and Apostolic faith. Remember, Lord, your servants. And all gathered here, whose faith and devotion are known to you, for them we offer you the sacrifice of praise, or they offer it for themselves and all who are dear to them, for the redemption of their souls and hope of health and well-being, in paying their homage to you, the eternal God, living and true. In communion with those whose memory we venerate, especially the glorious ever-Virgin Mary, Mother of our God and Lord Jesus Christ, and Blessed Joseph, her spouse, your blessed apostles and martyrs, Peter and Paul, Andrew, James, John, Thomas, James, Philip, Bartholomew, Matthew, Simon, and Jude, Linus, Cletus, Clement, Sixtus, Cornelius, Cyprian, Lawrence, Chrysogonus, John and Paul, Cosmas, and Damian, and all your saints. We ask that through their merits and prayers and all things we may be defended by your protecting help. Therefore, Lord, we pray, graciously accept this oblation of our service, that of your whole family. Order our days in your peace, and command that we be delivered from eternal damnation and counted among the flock of those you have chosen. Be pleased, O God, we pray, to bless, acknowledge, and approve this offering in every respect. Make it spiritual and acceptable, so that it may become for us the body and blood of your most beloved Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. On the day before he was to suffer, he took bread in his holy and venerable hands, and with eyes raised to heaven, to you, O God, his almighty Father, giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took this precious chalice in his holy and venerable hands. Once more giving you thanks, he said the blessing and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith.
We proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection until you come again.
Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the blessed passion, the resurrection from the dead, and the glorious ascension into heaven of Christ your Son, our Lord, we, your servants and your holy people, offer to your glorious majesty from the gifts that you have given us, this pure victim, this holy victim, this spotless victim, the holy bread of eternal life and the chalice of everlasting salvation. Be pleased to look upon these offerings with a serene and kindly countenance and to accept them, as once you were pleased to accept the gifts of your servant Abel the Just, the sacrifice of Abraham our father in faith, and the offering of your high priest Melchizedek, a holy sacrifice, a spotless victim. In humble prayer, we ask you, O mighty God, command that these gifts be borne by the hands of your holy angel to your altar on high in the sight of your divine majesty, so that all of us who through this participation at the altar receive the most holy body and blood of your Son may be filled with every grace and heavenly blessing. Remember also, Lord, your servants, who have gone before us with the sign of faith and rest in the sleep of peace. Grant them, O Lord, we pray, and all who sleep in Christ, a place of refreshment, light, and peace. To us also, your servants, who, though sinners, hope in your abundant mercies, graciously grant some share in fellowship with your holy apostles and martyrs, with John the Baptist, Stephen, Matthias, Barnabas, Ignatius, Alexander, Marcellinus, Peter, Felicity, Perpetua, Agatha, Lucy, Agnes, Cecilia, Anastasia, and all your saints. Admit us, we beseech you, into their company, not weighing our merits, but granting us your pardon, through Christ our Lord, through whom you continue to make all these good things, O Lord. You sanctify them, fill them with life, bless them, and bestow them upon us.
Through him and with him and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
At the Savior's command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church. Graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word and my soul shall be healed.
You shall cross the barren desert, but you shall not die of thirst. You shall wander far in safety, though you do not know the way. You shall speak your words in foreign lands, and all will understand. You shall see the face of God and live. Be not afraid. Thank you. that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. T'was grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did the grace appear, the hour I first believed. My chains are gone, I've been set
Please join me in prayer to Our Lady of Guadalupe for an end to this pandemic. Holy Virgin of Guadalupe, Queen of the Angels and Mother of the Americas, we fly to you today as your beloved children. We ask you to intercede for us with your Son, as you did at the wedding in Cana. Pray for us, loving Mother, and gain for our nation and world, and for all our families and loved ones, the protection of your holy angels, that we may be spared the worst of this illness. For those already afflicted, we ask you to obtain the grace of healing and deliverance. Hear the cries of those who are vulnerable and fearful. Wipe away their tears and help them to trust. In this time of trial and testing, teach all of us in the church to love one another and to be patient and kind. Help us to bring the peace of Jesus to our land and to our hearts. We come to you with confidence, knowing that you truly are our compassionate mother, health of the sick and cause of our joy. Shelter us under the mantle of your protection. Keep us in the embrace of your arms, and help us always to know the love of your Son, Jesus, in whose name we pray.
Amen.
Let us pray. May this divine sacrifice we have offered and receive fill us with life. O Lord, we pray, so that bound to you in lasting charity, we may bear fruit that lasts forever. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen. The Lord be with you. Bow your heads for God's blessing. O Lord, let the effect of your blessing remain with your faithful people, to give them new life and strength of spirit, so that the power of your love will enable them to accomplish what is right and good. And we ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Go in peace, glorifying the Lord by your life.
Thanks be to
God. Now thank we all, O God, with heart and hands and voices, who wondrous things hath done, in whom his world.
Sacrament most holy.
O sacrament.